Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this, our final joint summer service. After this week, each of our three churches, Glenburn, Craiga and Mount Pottinger, will be doing our own thing, whether that be in person at church or whether that be online. But we're so grateful and thankful that we have been able to join together in this way over the summer months. But you're very welcome this morning to this last service. I'm sure kids have been going back to school this week and different things have been happening. That means that we're getting back to a little bit more of normality. So as we come to worship this morning, let's take a moment to still our hearts before the Lord. The psalmist said, "Give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles and the judgments he pronounced. O descendants of Abraham, his servant, O sons of Jacob, his chosen ones." And so let us worship.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. That God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou
Loving God, Father of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, Lord of all the earth, friend and guide to your people across the ages, with joy and gladness we praise you. You have redeemed your people. You have shown your mercy. You have revealed your love. You have spoken through your prophets, you have lived among us, you have shared our life and death. You offer to all who truly seek you the assurance of your everlasting life. Loving God, as we draw near to you, draw near to us. As we seek your word, speak to us. As we confess our faults and failings, have mercy upon us. As we acknowledge the weakness and faithlessness of our discipleship, cleanse us through the saving love of Christ. As we are reminded of all you have done for us, challenge us to make our response. As we recognize our lack of vision and courage, inspire us through your Holy Spirit. Loving God, we come to study your word and to discover your will. Guide our reading, our listening, and our thinking, so that your message of old may be ever new in our hearts. Living God, all-knowing, all-powerful, all-seeing, ever-active and ever-present in our world. Help us to capture something of your wonder, to glimpse something of your greatness, to see that our small horizons are not the last word. Living God, teach us to see with your eyes. Enable us to see life from your perspective, with all its opportunities, potential, goodness, and beauty. Show us that where we see no future, your promise continues. Where we see only obstacles, you have planned the way through. Where we see only our limitations, you see opportunities. Where we see despair, you see hope. Where we see division, you work towards reconciliation. And where we see sorrow, you are longing to bring joy. Living God, teach us to see with your eyes. Give us the courage to dream dreams, to have a vision of the future for ourselves, our church, and all the world. Let us see with your eyes. Give us the faith to see life in a new light, a different way, and from a wider perspective. And give us the determination not just to dream, but to work towards the fulfillment of our vision, working for your kingdom here on earth. And so we join together in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from Exodus chapter 3, reading verses 1 to 15. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen how the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go, I am sending you to Pharaoh, to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 21. Love in action. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honour one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual favour serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope. Patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge. I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth planted deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness. Might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. And by grace we'll stand on your promises.
I was reading around the lectionary passages in preparation for today's service, and I came across a pastor's reflections as he wrote on Romans chapter 12, the passage that we've just heard. He began his reflections using an illustration from the Cold War, and it really caught my attention, and so I thought I would share it with you this morning. This is what he writes. In the mid-80s, when a Cold War still divided communist nations from democratic nations, and when concrete barriers and barbed wire fences divided East Berlin from West, there was a young man who passed through the Berlin Wall at Checkpoint Charlie nearly every day. Driving a pickup truck with a couple of bicycles tied to the top of the load, he would be stopped by German guards who would thoroughly search his possessions. Some days, under the bicycles and under the tarps, he would be carrying piles of sand, and the guards would empty every one of them onto the pavement looking for contraband. Other days, when the guards pulled off the bikes and the tarps, they found boxes of books, and they would unpack every book and leave them scattered on the ground. Still other days, he would be carrying pallets of blocks or rolls of sod. The routine was always the same. Stop the truck, inspect the load, and send the man on his way. Now, the guards never found anything illegal, but each day the young man was required to reload his truck, tie the tarps down, and throw the bikes back on top of the load. It was a daily inconvenience, as you can imagine. After the Berlin Wall fell in 1988, this young man met one of the border guards at a tavern in downtown Berlin. Over glasses of beer, they reminisced about the loads that he carried and the daily ritual that they now laughed about. Then the former guard got serious and said, "Comrade, we know you were smuggling something, but we could never figure out what it was. Now that the danger has passed," the older man said, "tell me what it was you were smuggling." The younger man answered, "Bicycles. I was smuggling bicycles." Pastor reflects, sometimes in this life, the most obvious things are right in front of us, and yet we fail to see them. A promising business opportunity, or a potential marriage partner, or the possibility of an exciting adventure goes unnoticed because we're looking for something else. A current television ad shows a man jogging through a city neighbourhood, wondering what kind of car to purchase, and he's oblivious to more than a dozen different Volkswagen Jettas that nearly run him over on his route. It is reminiscent of the proverbial man caught in a flood who turns down the life raft and a canoe and a helicopter because he is waiting for God to save him. The German border guard was looking for something secretive in the young man's truck, something hidden to the naked eye. Yet, all along, the illegal import was in plain sight, and he missed it. I think many Christians in today's culture are guilty of the very same thing. As I read this reflection, I was really struck by it. Are we guilty of doing the same thing? Of missing the clear instruction of Scripture about how we are supposed to live in our everyday lives because we overcomplicate it or overthink, or perhaps we distort the words that we read because, well, we don't really like what it asks of us. At the beginning of Romans chapter 12, we read Paul say to the church, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing and perfect will." Well, it might be really easy to look at those verses and say, well, what does that really mean? How do we really offer ourselves as a living sacrifice to God? What does it mean for us to be holy? What might it mean for us to be in contrast to the pattern of this world? Well, the answer, it seems, lies right in front of us as we read on in this chapter. It's fairly plain and simple, but it's a challenge for sure. Verse 9 begins, "Your love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good." When we read the word sincere and we look back at the original language that is used, it speaks of a love that is without hypocrisy, a love that is genuine, a love without a hidden agenda. And when it says, hate what is evil, the evil that we understand here is anything that would be in opposition to the ways and the holiness of God, which as we understand it, is not just simply external factors that are around us, but also factors that can lie within us. So hate the pride, the prejudice, the greed, the gossip, I could go on. In this one line, the challenge is set high for us. Offering ourselves as a living sacrifice to God is a pursuing of genuine love and a clinging to what is good and holy. The passage then goes on to paint a really tall order before us. Be devoted to each other, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, be generous, practice hospitality, bless those that persecute you, rejoice when there is rejoicing, mourn when there is mourning. Live in harmony with each other. Have no pride. Don't be conceited. Be people of integrity. Don't seek after revenge, which implies let go of those grudges. Overcome evil with good. It's a tall order, right? But yet, no hidden secret about what it means to be a person who follows God. And that tall order is how we are best to reflect God, so that he is visible to others through us and the way that we live. When we fall short and others are watching our example, well, it means that this image of God falls short in their eyes too. Now, I know that we're all human, and being human means that we are full of imperfections and that there are, of course, times when we fail because we're not God. But we should not make that reality of our humanity an excuse not to try and not to pursue godliness as we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice to him. I wonder if we were to individually look through these verses of 9 to 21 of chapter 12, would we find that there are areas that we need to really work on? I wonder if we were to look through the verses as church and communities of faith, would we find that we measure up? Are we devoted to one another? Are we living in harmony? Are we generous and hospitable, sincere and patient? Are we blessing those that are persecuting us, letting go of grudges, being people with ultimate integrity? I hope that we could answer an unreserved yes to all of those things. However, I imagine if we are honest, we would know that there are one or two areas in which we need to work a little harder, both individually and corporately as church. As we find ourselves beginning to navigate our way back to a new normal for gathering in worship, I wonder, do we have an opportunity to examine our ways and our practices alongside these verses and to seek to improve on our love for one another and our love for those that God has placed around us? Maybe this is a perfect time for us to weed out any negative practices or attitudes that have existed in us a time to give way to these long-held grudges and to actively pursue this understanding of offering ourselves as a living sacrifice to God. There's one other verse that I haven't yet mentioned from this passage that caught my attention this week and probably challenged me the most. Paul says, "Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervour serving the Lord." If we look up the word zeal in the dictionary, it describes it as having great energy and enthusiasm in pursuit of a cause. So Paul is urging the church to have great energy and great enthusiasm in the pursuit of God and the spreading of the gospel message. The word fervour means an intense or passionate feeling, so Paul is emphasising that they are to keep their spiritual passion in serving the Lord. Serving is a vital part of keeping our energy for God. Serving Him is to energise us, and our energy should be found when we are serving. We should not come to service begrudgingly or uncaringly, but with passion and energy and enthusiasm for the one that we serve deserves nothing less. In a world of weariness and overcommitment, this is perhaps an interesting verse for us to hear. The Message version paraphrases it like this: "Don't burn out. Keep yourselves fueled and inflamed. Be alert servants of the Master, cheerfully expectant." As I read this verse, I'm challenged to examine my own sense of weariness and my own passion. But I'm also challenged to see that within this verse, and indeed all of these verses that we've looked at today, that there is an onus on us. These verses require our attention. They require our effort and our persistence. Keep yourselves fueled and inflamed. There is no room in these verses for complacency. There is no room for laziness or inattention. They speak of a continued effort in our following of God. If we think of our bodies, we all know that to keep our bodies healthy, well, we need to eat well, exercise, and drink plenty of water. If we feel unwell, we will go and see a doctor, and perhaps the doctor will give us some medication. But if we don't actually take the medication, then how can we expect to get well? And honestly, I'm pretty terrible at remembering to take tablets. So I'll go through seasons where I'll think, oh, maybe I'll feel better if I start taking some vitamins. And I'll go out and I'll buy the vitamins and I'll put them in the cupboard. That's where they stay. And then I forget to actually take them. It's as if buying them and placing them in the cupboard is simply enough to make my immune system grow. It makes no sense, right? Well, neither does going to church, yet not engaging in study and prayer the rest of the week. Just being in the building won't make you grow in Christ. You have to make the effort. I have to make the effort. We have to make time to study and learn, to wrestle with the difficult questions. We have to make the difficult choices to go against the pattern of this world in the pursuit of the holiness of God. So when we read, "Never be lacking in zeal," well, it tells us that we need to make effort. So I need to invest and protect my spiritual health. I need to serve the Lord with passion and energy, not with weariness or grumbles. I need to let go of pet peeves for the sake of being devoted to one another and living in harmony. I need to persevere with patience and be generous with my hospitality. I need to keep a check on my pride and always ensure that my integrity is found in all my actions. And why? Because the gracious and most loving God that we are invited to know deserves nothing less. He offered a sacrifice of great extravagance in the death of Christ. He who was sinless took on the sinfulness of the world so that we might experience freedom and life in all of its fullness. Shouldn't my response be to give my very best? Shouldn't that also be your response? And if we read this passage in Romans and find that it exposes areas within our lives or our faith communities that require some work, then perhaps that would suggest that we're not giving of our best. As we come to the end of sharing together in these joint services online and work our way back to our own individual patterns of sharing inside our buildings or streaming or through recorded services, My prayer is that we might hear Paul's words today of never lacking in zeal and really take them to heart. That we might see our own responsibility to work and invest in our own spiritual health for the sake of the gospel, and that we might not become weary of serving one another in love. As we respond to the circumstances of this world, let us be found people who are not lacking in zeal, but are keeping our spiritual fervor as we serve the Lord. Amen.
Father God, we come to you now to pray for the needs of others. We think this morning especially of our young people and children who have been returning to school under very different circumstances with all of the restrictions that have come with COVID. Father, we pray for our children that you would take away any anxieties that they might have, any worries about going to school. Father, that you would take away any uncertainties. Father, that it would be a time to spend with friends, having not seen them for a long time. Would it be a time of learning and of fun? May our children know your safety and protection as they try to return to normal. We think too of their parents as they send their children to school. Would you please take away any anxieties that they may have, knowing that their children will be safe and protected? As we pray for the children and parents, we pray for the teachers. Father, we pray for school leadership teams as they try to make decisions regarding the school. Father, would they know your discernment and wisdom in all decisions that they make? Father, we pray too for our churches. Many now are open, and we pray for those that will be opening within the next couple of weeks. Father, we pray again for your protection and for your safety in those places. Father, that we would be able to return to worship you and praise you in your house. Father, today we think of all those who have been affected by the flooding from the recent storms. We think particularly of people in Newcastle and that general area. Father, it's so horrible to see people's homes full of water having to be taken away on dinghies and boats. Father, we give thanks for our emergency services, for first responders who are on the scene straight away, for our fire department, for the police, for the RNLI, for ambulance services. Father, we give thanks for all that they do in our communities to keep us safe. We think now a little further afield. We think of the riots that have been happening in America, particularly in Wisconsin. Father, we pray for equality for all races. No one should be afraid because of who they are. We have all been created by you and in your image. And we know that you love each and every one of us. And so, Father, we pray for those riots and pray that you would set yourself before them. Father, that your love and your grace would overcome everything. This morning, we pray for those in our congregations who are perhaps sick, in hospital, in homes, awaiting tests, or waiting for results. We pray for all of those anxieties. Father, we pray for your peace upon all those who are ill. We pray to you this morning for those who have been bereaved in recent days. Father, may they know your comfort and your peace above all. In the quietness now, we lift up the names of those known to us who need a touch from the Master this morning. Father, we pray that you would come, bringing your healing and your hope. Father, we lay these prayers down in front of you, asking for your peace upon us all. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Thank you for joining with us over these past couple of months as we have shared together in joint services of worship between Mount Pottinger Craiga and Glenburn. It has been a real joy to know that we are united in our thought and our prayer as we have journeyed through the last few weeks. as we find our own way back to our own services, either meeting together in our buildings or through our own streaming services. Let's continue to be mindful of each other, to pray for one another and to encourage each other as we navigate our way through the next days and weeks that lie ahead of us that still contain much uncertainty. Let's be mindful to cover each other in prayer and to be quick to encourage. As we come to close in our worship, let's one final time share together in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.